In the last 3 years, there has been a lot of talk about quantum computers, with vastly differing opinions on when they will be fully functional and how they might impact our lives. In this context, it is often said that quantum computers use a fundamentally different syntax for their operations, which is advantageous for solving specific problems. This video demonstrates the differences between classical and quantum computing by examining how these architectures perform the simple summation of two integers. We'll first look at how logical gates are electronically constructed in classical hardware and then combined to form a full adder unit. Afterwards, we'll build the same unit using quantum hardware. A normal computer processes information in terms of bits. A bit, stemming from the word binary, is essentially just an electrical switch with the two configurations off and on, which we interpret as 0 and 1. In order to write larger numbers with these switches, we use the binary counting system in which each digit represents a power of 2. This is just a way of writing numbers with 2 instead of the familiar 10 digits from our decimal system. In electrical engineering notation, each bit is drawn as a switch icon, where the V symbolizes the voltage source and the line the ground, given the convention that current flows from source to ground. Storing an integer such as 42 in your computer then corresponds to electronically configuring the binary logarithm of 42 many switches inside its hardware. To perform logical operations such as additions on stored bits, we need what are called gates. One important example are AND gates, which are for the most part just two switches corresponding to the input bits A and B in series. Current can only reach the light bulb, which represents our output bit X, if both switches are closed. Hence, X is only set to 1 if both A and B have value 1. We can summarize the input-output relation of this gate in a so-called truth table. Similarly, we can also construct a gate with two switches in parallel. In this setup, current can reach the light bulb if at least one of the switches is closed. Hence, X is 1 if either A or B or both have value 1, which is why this is called an OR gate. Then there is the NOT gate, which only takes one input bit and simply inverts it. The electronics behind this might be a bit less intuitive, but closing the switch here creates a direct connection from source to ground, which shorts the circuit. Similar to water in a sink, the voltage level in a circuit drops to 0 when there's a direct path to the drain. Now, while you could come up with many more gates, these three simple designs can actually be combined to perform any logical operation. They are what's called a universal set of gates. In fact, just the NOT gate and one of the others are already sufficient. Yet, to construct a unit that can add together two numbers, it is convenient to introduce another gate, which can be constructed with the three gates from before, as shown here. This gate is referred to as XOR, where the X stands for exclusive. Looking at its truth table, we see that it outputs a 1 only when either A or B are 1, but not when both of them are 1, as was the case for the OR gate. Now we have everything to build an adder unit, but we should first go through how addition looks like in our new numbering system. Let's start by adding 1 to 1. In the decimal system, this would simply result in 2. However, in the binary system, a digit cannot exceed 1. Therefore, just as the sum of two digits exceeding 9 in the decimal notation results in a carryover, the sum of two binary digits exceeding 1 also results in a carryover to the next digit. We hence obtain 10 as the binary notation of the number 2. To physically implement this addition using the gates we've discussed earlier, we input the bits A and B into both an XOR gate and an AND gate. The XOR gate will provide us with the first digit of the addition, known as the sum, while the AND gate will produce the second digit, referred to as the carry. We can briefly convince ourselves that this gives the expected result. When both A and B are set to 1, the XOR gate outputs 0, while the AND gate outputs 1. The result reads 10 as expected. Feel free to pause the video here and try the other three input combinations to see that this design functions properly. Nonetheless, this unit is only called a half adder because it is incapable of adding together longer bit strings. You see, what we'd want is a setup through which we can iteratively feed the digits of two summons and collect the result at the end. To illustrate that this cannot be achieved with half adders, consider the following addition. In the second digit, we again get a carryover. This obviously needs to be taken into account when summing the next column. Therefore, in order to sum two arbitrary numbers, we need a third input port that holds a possible carry in for the next iteration. To construct a unit with three ports that fulfills this criterion, we can simply combine two half adders and one OR gate. This is known as a full adder and answers our question about how an addition is performed on classical hardware. Remember that all these units are nothing but different arrangements of wires, switches, and resistors. You could buy an electronics kit on Amazon to build one at home. Now, in the device you're watching this on, what I refer to as switches for the input and output ports are in fact transistors. So in real-world hardware engineering, we'd hence translate the full adder into a CMOS diagram, yet the core concepts remain the same. So there you have it. This is how a classical computer adds together two numbers. Now let's see how the same task is implemented on a quantum computer. The differences start at the most fundamental unit of information processing. Instead of a binary bit system, a quantum computer works with quantum bits, short qubits. Qubits are often introduced as continuous bits. While classical bits can only take on values 0 or 1, qubits can also hold any value in between. While this is not incorrect, a more accurate way of visualizing qubits is as a point on the surface of a sphere. The height of this point with respect to the vertical axis again represents the bit value, which you can think of as a weighted combination of 0 and 1. Yet there's also another degree of freedom in form of the rotation in the horizontal plane of the sphere. We call this the qubit's phase. Now you might be wondering, if a bit represents a switch that can be either on or off, what is the analogy for a qubit? The answer is a switch that can be on and off simultaneously by being in what's called a superposition. This state of matter isn't visible at our length scales, but plays a central role in the dimensions of atoms and electrons. I made a separate video about these states in case you want to dive in a little deeper. Having accepted this quantum nature, let's turn to how logical operations can be applied to a qubit in a quantum computer. There are two important types of quantum gates. The first are single qubit gates, which simply rotate the arrow in the sphere introduced earlier. The simplest way to be able to move this arrow to any point on the sphere's surface is using the three continuous rotation gates around the x, y, and z axis, which rotate the qubit around their respective axis by a tunable angle. Yet you can also achieve this via a set of gates with fixed rotational values, which can be easier to implement at times. However, neither of these approaches is universal in the sense that they suffice to perform an arbitrary computation. For this, we also need the second type of gates, two-qubit gates. These gates perform operations on two qubits simultaneously. The most important subgroup of them are controlled gates that perform a certain operation on one qubit, called target, depending on the state of another qubit, called control. There is, for example, the controlled NOT gate, short CNOT, which flips the target qubit only if the control qubit is in the 1 state, and otherwise leaves it unchanged. An important theorem in quantum computing states that one control gate, like the CNOT gate, together with any complete set of single qubit gates, such as the three continuous rotations, is in fact universal. So we already found everything needed to perform an addition. However, so far we only looked at the theoretical concepts, and you might wonder how one actually achieves this in practice, how the physical implementation looks like. Well, the problem is there is no general answer here. You see, while all classical computers essentially have the same architecture, there are currently many different approaches to quantum computing and a lot of debate about which is most effective. There are, for instance, the superconducting qubit enjoyers, among which we find IBM and Google. Then there are trapped ion designs and the latest trend, neutral atoms, as well as many other things. While the abstract concept of quantum gates remains consistent across most platforms, the implementations can vary significantly. To provide you at least with a glimpse of how this could look like, I will briefly outline the physics behind the controlled NOT gate for a neutral atom system, which I find to be one of the more intuitive examples. As the name suggests, this architecture utilizes neutrally charged atoms, encoding bit values in the degree of excitation of the outermost electron. You may think of this as the distance between the electron and the nucleus of the atom. In addition to the 0 and 1 state, we also use an auxiliary state that is highly excited, meaning the electron is very far away from the center. To move the electron into this highly excited state, we need to provide the right amount of energy corresponding to what it needs to bridge the distance, which can be done with correctly adjusted laser beams. So for example, a laser adjusted to the zero state to auxiliary state transition would trigger a transition for a qubit in the zero state, but not for a qubit in the one state. Since the auxiliary state is very far away, the negatively charged electron in this state forms what is called a dipole charge with the positively charged core. As you may recall from high school, like charges repel each other. This means that when another atom is nearby, it becomes more difficult to also bring that atom into the dipole state. The charge distribution of the first atom increases the energy required to recreate the state in the second atom. Now let's see how this plays into the CNOT sequence. First, consider the case with the control qubit in the one state. We start by applying the laser pulse corresponding to the energy difference between the zero and the auxiliary state to this atom. In this case, the pulse doesn't match the distance and nothing happens. In the second step, we then apply the NOT sequence to the target qubit. This involves moving its electron to the auxiliary state, which requires a laser to drive transitions from both the zero state and the one state. There are also additional rotations in the qubit sphere needed, but we'll set those details aside for now. Ultimately, the target qubit is inverted by transitioning to the auxiliary state and falling back down. However, if the control qubit is initially in the zero state, then the first pulse will be resonant, which means that the transition takes place and a strong dipole is created. Due to Coulomb repulsion, this increases the energy cost for the transition of the target qubit. The same laser pulses as before will now be off-resonant so that the transition and hence the inversion doesn't occur. In other words, the inversion only happens when the control qubit starts in the one state. We have successfully built a CNOT gate. This demonstration was already somewhat simplified, but it might still be a bit overwhelming. Yet moving forward, it is enough to remember the general principle of a CNOT gate. Let's finally look at how we can use our quantum gates to add together two numbers. With a complete set of single qubit gates and a two qubit CNOT gate, we can implement any unitary algorithm. But similar to how we introduced the not strictly necessary XOR gate in our discussion of the classical adder, it is likewise convenient to introduce the so-called Toffoli or CC NOT gate, a NOT gate with two control qubits. It flips the target qubit if and only if both control qubits are in the one state and is hence similar to the AND gate in classical computing. With the Toffoli gate and a CNOT gate, we can construct a simple quantum adder unit. Let's use the setup to add together the numbers 1 and 3. We begin by initializing two qubit registers A and B with the binary encoding of these numbers, just like we would on classical hardware. We further initialize a sum and a carry qubit in the zero state to store our results. As with the classical adder before, we perform the addition bitwise, starting from the least significant bits. We now begin with the Toffoli gate with the least significant bits A0 and B0 as controls to check if their sum produces a carry. Since both of them are 1, this is indeed the case and the Toffoli gate flips the carry qubit to 1. Then we apply a CNOT gate between these qubits to account for the extracted carryover. Another CNOT gate with B0 as control stores the XOR operation of A0 and B0 in the sum qubit. This gate doesn't trigger in our case, and the sum qubit remains in the zero state. This concludes the addition of the least significant bits, and one more CNOT gate on A0 and B0 returns them into their original states.
By reading out the sum qubit, we obtain a 0 as the least significant bit of our result.
We now turn to the second bit and repeat the same procedure as before, with the only exception that we must in principle add another Toffoli gate with B1 and the sum qubit as control to allow a potential carry to propagate, though this gate isn't triggered in case of our example. Once the full sequence has been applied, we again measure the sum and carry qubit. As both of them are now in the one state, they add to 1, 0.
Combining both steps, we obtain the three-digit number 100, the binary representation of 4, which successfully concludes this quantum addition.
Now, with all the hype around quantum technologies, you probably wonder how much better the quantum adder is compared to the classical version from earlier. The answer is, for the simple arithmetic operations discussed in this video, there is no foreseeable quantum advantage. In fact, we are only aware of a significant quantum speedup for a very limited set of algorithms. Still, I think this example nicely illustrates some of the key features of quantum and classical information processing, and might also help to understand those cases where the quantum architecture actually outperforms the classical one. Alright, that's it for today. Let me know if you want to hear more about quantum computing, and thank you for watching.